Paradigm shift.
An educational comedy.
It's not a cause. Not a movement.
It's not a social group you can slap a label onto.
It's an idea. It's an intention.
It's an intuition.
A mindset in which reality can be explored.
A genuine expression.
A sermon.
Critical thinking and imagination.
To look inward upon ourselves.
To better understand the external world around us.
And yes,
few egos are bound to be bruised.
With our silly, strange, politically incorrect.
Your style of going about things.
Real and raw honesty.
Which invites you to be
to the fullest.
And here we go. We're live on air. Hello, everybody. And welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. And back once again, we have Max Igan. Absolutely love this guy. Known him for a few years now, and you know, he's been doing his own work with you know, his radio show and all of his travels and this, that, and the other, and doing his thing even long before I met him. And like, Max is just a really, really, really great guy, and you know, it is absolutely my privilege to know him and be a friend of his. And that's not to put him on a pedestal. As Max likes to say, he's a regular human being, equal to everybody else. And you know, that's the way I feel about myself and everybody else too. But you know, just giving credit where credit is due, and just, you know, showing Max's level of, you know, just his integrity and, you know, the type of person that he is. He's definitely the sort of person that understands what being a genuine friend is. And and also, just to let everybody know, straight out the gate, I did help Max set up his Patreon account. So anybody that wants to help him out, that's like the only way he's making money right now. So anybody who wants to support his shows and wants to see his shows continue, just go to patreon.com/Max Igan. And, you know, you can help him out for as little as $1 a month. And we also have a Patreon account as well, patreon.com/PSEC Media, P-S-E-C Media. So, welcome back, Max.
Pleasure, brother. Thanks for asking me on. Sorry it's taken so long to get here. A lot of trouble with the internet. That's what you're doing. Hard drives fail, and you know, life in the Amazon.
Yeah, it's so all good.
We've got a limited window here today because I've been told they're coming to pull down at some stage this morning, so it's a never-ending saga, but we're here while we can be anyway.
Yeah, plus to let everybody know, there's a slight amount of lag latency, so me and Max are not actually intentionally trying to interrupt each other. It's just that silences versus speaking can get slightly mistimed, so when you think there's a spot, there's actually not. So it's I guess live stream bumper cars, I suppose. Oh, it is just been an interesting year even so far. For each year I just kind of tend to have an intuition about what the general theme of it's going to be, and then I give it a name. And these last few years so far I've been right. I'm not sure where exactly this comes from. Well, of course I do, we're all connected to source and all that. But 2015 was the year of action, 2016 the year of discovery, and 2017 the year of integration. And you know, as we know, especially for like discovery, there's a lot of purification involved, and in order to be purified, you got to face your mess, you know, deal with your demons, deal with your shit, get yourself sorted out. So of course you saw a lot of stuff with, you know, social justice warriors and, you know, people being emotionally triggered and all sorts of crazy. And now in 2017, and like from my experiences, and you could tell me whether or not you've had similar phenomenon, my experiences both on, you know, just in the level of being me and what's being reflected in my own life, plus friends and family around me, and, you know, just on the global stage, like I see this like in the whole fractal, it's crazy. Like right now, Max is asking if he wants me to share a link as far as the stream that's on now. Yeah, there should be. Okay.
Sorry to have interrupted your flow. I didn't mean to.
It's all good. Let me give you a link that you can give to people so that they can, you know, listen to the stream and whatever, and you could say that you're live now with that. There's the link for viewers who want to check that out. You can post that okay. on your social media.
Oh, good. So please continue.
Yep. Sure. But anyway, what I've noticed is in 2017 really seems to be very already starting intensely, just everybody being triggered on certain issues and a lot of facing of paradigms and clearing and integration, because there seems to be like this, I'm noticing this major rise in compassion. Like I've noticed that everything seems to come in waves. Like if you go all the way back, you know, first there was like, you know, in the 90s and before, just the little fringe elements, the people who were awake, quote unquote. We did not have all this broadband and everything else. Then after 9/11, you know, the truth movement built up its momentum. But even though the truth movement is well-intended, because of the massive lack of compassion within the truth movement, it's only been able to get so far. And like, you've ranted on that at length, Max. I mean, definitely, and so have I. But you notice that everything evolves up to a certain point, and then something new ends up blooming out of it. So first you have the oblivious mainstream, and what ends up blooming out of it because of whistleblowers is the fringe stuff in the 80s and 90s. Then once the fringe stuff hit its limit, the truth movement bloomed out of that synchronistically, and because of 9/11, thank you elites. Well, now because of the, you know, the infighting and all of the intensity and all that within the truth movement, now there seems to be this, for lack of a better word, and I don't even want to call it a movement. It's more like an idea whose time has come, as you've liked to explain it. I just have been referring to it as the wave of compassion that's just been bombarding the planet. And depending on how much shit a person has to clear or not, this wave of compassion can make people react very lovingly, and I mean in a genuine way, not like that new agey fake shit. As a matter of fact, I've seen it starting to shake, you know, some sense into some new agers, and go, and they're like, wow, the shun the dark stuff, I had it all wrong. I need to face the mess, not ignore it. And then of course, somebody who's got too much negative and too much hate and too much prejudice and all of that built up in them, they get hit by the wave of compassion, and it's so different from that frequency. So how are they going to react? Of course, they're going to retaliate against it. So I've also seen incidents where people get super triggered just from somebody being polite to them, you know? And when it happens, even the person being triggered seems confused because, you know, even from their perception, it seems a little over the top even for them. And not to mention, it's already been scientifically proven that, you know, we are moving into a new area of space physically. The photon belt does exist and all of that. So there's definitely changes in frequency, changes, or just all this rapid change. Like there's this domino effect, this expansion, like we're giving birth to a new and better world, but the earth is going through a lot of labor pains and there's no epidural drip. Have your experiences been matching similar observations? I'm just curious.
Well, yeah, there's certainly waves of compassion that are happening, but I mean, the energy is really shifting. It's like people have had they've been ripped up by their anchors pulled out, sort of thing. And not only just pulled out, but like ripped out. You know, people are dealing with sort of energies that they've never dealt with before, and a lot of people are having a hard time dealing with it, you know. We're heading for some really, really bizarre times. We are. And there's so much division happening at the moment as well, but I think what we're really being given here is an opportunity, a chance for mankind to stand up and wake up to itself. I really do. I think this whole Trump presidency and everything that's brought this about and everything that we went through in the last year, which was certainly a year of revealing and a year of discovery. It was a year where a lot of things revealed themselves. It was like a trial by fire for the empath last year. It really was. It was for me. It was for a lot of people that I know, like everybody that I know. Went through extremely rough times last year. So I think this year, I mean, it's so confusing. I mean, people are so confused at the state of the world politically and energetically that it's anybody's guess where we're going to go. But ultimately, it's going to come down to the people. This is what I've been saying all along, even when it became apparent that Trump was going to be elected. I said, it's not going to matter what he does. It's going to matter what the people do with the opportunity that this provides. So yeah, there's some really bizarre stuff going on. And it's anybody's guess as to where we're going to go, but I think we're going to see a lot of stuff revealed this year. I think we're at a turning point. If the people are prepared to put down this whole left-right paradigm and this identity politics that they're all getting involved in, because that's really what we've seen in this last election, they can put all that aside and realize that now's the time for the human race to unite and find a way out of this mess, and we will find a way out of it. You know, the problem is, I mean, with this last election, it's probably the only election that we've seen recently, or the most predominant election, where everybody who voted kind of voted because they hated the opposition. Most of the people who voted for Clinton didn't really want her in, but they just didn't want Trump in. And most of the people who voted for Trump just didn't want Clinton in. So that's really bizarre. That's complete identity politics and complete division. And it's been designed and constructed that way. I mean, I think that... all of this is a play, I really do. For a while, I was very excited.
It's a shell game.
Well, yeah, for a while, I was very excited that Trump got elected, and I thought, well, this is going to shift things. This is something new that I don't know what's going to happen, because I've really got no knowledge of Donald Trump. He's not someone I've researched or really investigated his life much at all. And I thought, well, this is a wild card. It could go any way. So good that he got elected, because it shows, I mean, out of everything, even if he is a player, it still shows that the people were pissed off enough with what they had that anything was better than what they had. And if it wasn't Trump, it would have been someone else. It's the same with what we saw in Australia in the last election. So many major parties had voted for independence. So whether that's good or not, it shows that people are annoyed with what they've had. They've just had enough of this system. They want some way out, any way out. You know, they've gone for Trump thinking that's what's going to lead them to safety. I think they've been played with that one. But maybe that will provide an opportunity for them to see that there are no leaders and actually have to take responsibility for themselves. So that's maybe what this year will be. If what you say, this wave of compassion is happening, I mean, there's definitely something happening. The energy is really shifting. Everybody that I know can feel it, and I can feel it. It's just strange. The year, everything, it doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel normal. It almost feels like we've entered a different reality, like the Mandela effect's real or something. We're in a parallel reality.
Yeah.
I mean, there's something.
Totally, and it's becoming more and more, you know, apparent. I'm like really tired, and I'm just running on, you know, like caffeine and nicotine here. So everybody, excuse any like any fogginess or lack of clarity here. But one thing that I've noticed that I think both you and the viewers will be interested in, and this is just an observation of mine, I'm not saying I'm right or wrong, I'm just saying as the years continue to unfold, this can be used as a little bit of a curiosity measure to help vet things. 2012, as some people may or may not know, is the middle point of the precession of the equinoxes. There's 18 years on either side, because, you know, on the cosmic scale, you know, our sun, our solar system is moving through space at near the speed of light, while at the same time our planet is whipping around that sun at like 10,000 miles, you know, per hour, and at the same time, you know, we're, you know, spinning at 1,000 miles per hour. It's pretty mind-boggling to think about. But so it's not like it's a line that the Earth steps over to where it's like, okay, we have the precession. It's not like jumping from one sidewalk tile to the other. It's this 36-year period. So if you 2013 seems to have been like year zero, like a recalibration period. 2012 is like that middle line where, you know, we crossed out of the old reality and into the new reality. But just because you go into something new doesn't mean you're instantly evolved. Like, you know, just because a baby is born into this new reality doesn't mean they're instantly a college graduate. Things take time. So I've noticed that collectively, as above, so below, because everything's a fractal metaphor of everything else. If 2013 is year zero, if we look at how people acted in 2014, metaphorically speaking, if we view the collective of humanity almost as like one person or one little child, humanity became 1 year old in 2014. Before then, we weren't even birthed, right? So how do one-year-olds act? And how is the consciousness of humanity acting in 2014? If you look, you've got a match. You go to 2015, humanity's two. Now, did humanity seem to be acting like a two-year-old in 2015? Oh yeah, big time. 2016, how does a three-year-old act? Was humanity as a collective whole acting the way a three-year-old would act in terms of development as an individual? Yes, it was. And 2017, are we starting to act four? Well, look at the perfect timing with this wave of compassion. Age four is really when the brain starts to have more solid formation of neural networks to be able to handle more complex information, you know, both cerebrally and emotionally. So if we look at it in you know, that fractal metaphor, it seems that if we look at 2013 as year zero, and we think of the whole collective of humanity as, you know, being almost like its own individual person, and in 2013 humanity turned one, and as we look at the progression as we go forward in time, it'll be very interesting if that trend continues to keep aligned to those years as time goes forward. And if it does remain aligned, then if 18 is considered species maturity, then we don't have long to go. And if we don't have long to go, then that means, you know, in less than 18 years, the world is going to be changing exponentially. And that's exactly what we have been seeing, is an exponentially changing world. And then, of course, you've got the contrast, the dark and the light colliding, like hot and cold and steam, and, you know. But I thought you might find that fascinating.
Yeah, that's an interesting analogy. It'll be quite interesting to see. I mean, I hope it does change that quickly. And like, if the world hasn't changed in the next 18 years, then, well, God help us all. But hopefully we'll have got out in this mess way before then. I think there's been so much revealed recently. Like, there really has. I don't know if you've been following.
Oh, yeah.
Like the work of George Webb with the Clinton emails and DynCorp and all the human trafficking. I mean, we've been talking about this for years. I've been talking about the fact that the human race is being farmed for years and years. And, you know, people farming, that's what our government's been doing. I've been talking about the fact that there's a dark ring of pedophiles that exist behind this reality. And there's a whole reality that exists behind this society, which is essentially farming this society. And what's happened with the revelations in the Clinton emails is that now it's all provable. Now it's all there in their own hands. Everything we've been talking about is there. And you can see how all these wars are manufactured and contrived. You can see what the governments are really doing. It's not about helping anybody. It's about controlling people and harvesting people. That's what governments are doing. Harvesting not just people, but resources and taking over countries and just basically setting up their new world order and their control grid. And nothing's changed. With the Trump presidency, nothing's changed. But people are seeing it now. And the Trump presidency is such a debacle. It's such a circus that hopefully people are going to see, look, this is all such a play. This whole political thing is such a play. All this talk of national security and all these spy agencies and all these war machines and all this rubbish, we don't need any of it. We don't. So hopefully that's what we're going to see from this. So it's all happened for a reason. It really has. I mean, the last year, as hard as it was very, very necessary. And what we're seeing unfold this year is one of the greatest opportunities we've ever had. I just say bring it on. I mean, let it get more ridiculous. Let Trump do more outrageous things and let people scream louder and louder about it. But just if you're out there watching it, just break out of this left-right paradigm. Don't join a side, because that's what they want you to do. They want you to either be for Trump or against Trump and fight with the other guys. That's what they want. They don't care which side you join. They don't care whether you're for him or against him. They don't care what you believe in, as long as you adopt a belief and you fight with people who don't have that same belief. So step back from all of that and realize that we're all one species here on this earth doing this together. And we have a real opportunity here to free ourselves from this criminal puppet show that's been running things for so many years. I mean, literally centuries, yeah. These people have been running things. And now we've got an opportunity to deal with that. And this whole farce of the Trump presidency will hopefully make people wake up to the power that they have. So, I mean, he comes across kind of as one real thing, guy as well. You know, he's got Twitter and he's got all this sort of stuff. So the fact that he's the president and he's doing all this normal stuff, this is good. It shows he's a normal guy. There's just normal people on Earth here, folks. There's no rulers. Nobody has a right of ownership over you.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I do like that. I do like that about Trump, because we as a society have been taught to put social titles on a pedestal of authority and, you know, act as if, you know, someone has this title, this means they must be better than them, higher than them, above them. And to see someone that we're used to having, you know, this sort of authoritative type of title, then go ahead and very publicly just act like a regular human being, for both better and worse, depending on exactly what you're talking about, you know. But showing
there's always a disconnect between us and the president or whatever. With Trump, there isn't that disconnect. I mean, that's he might think that he's warming for the people that way, but really he's created a vulnerable point, because he's shown people that there's no real leaders here. It's just people, and it's a good thing.
Yeah. Here's also why this is important, and it's coming in perfect alignment with things as well. Like I said, with this wave of compassion coming in, and you know what I'm about to say is something I've known even before then, and I'm happy to see this wave coming in. But the biggest, hugest thing that holds people locked into their complacency, and I mean, you know, as we've seen, even people who are for the most part quote unquote awake, or at the very least aware of things going on, although as my friend Melanie or Mel V from CCN likes to say, if you lack compassion, you're not awake. And that's not even a diss on anybody, but you know, that's just like saying, you know, fire's hot. It's just, you know, it is what it is. But I've noticed that with, you know, compassion, or if you want to call it higher vibrational frequency, slamming into all of the negativity inside of all of us, or lower vibrational frequency, if you want to call it that, what then comes up for everyone to face has been the very thing locking people into complacency. And that thing is the number one weapon that the elites have always used against us, and that thing being shame. Because one of the biggest things, the whole, like, we're taught to devalue our own self-worth. And of course, you know, the Bible even says that we will love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And a lot of people tend to think they're worthless pieces of shit, so they similarly love their neighbors, they love themselves. But anyway, when this compassion starts to hit the shame, then people start having to face it and face their self-worth issues instead of going into complacent denial. And, you know, it's engines like, you know, the fashion industry and all these sorts of things that have promoted the shame. And what's been happening, you know, over the years as people have been awakening, they awaken to certain aspects of how the mind matrix works, right? And like conceptually, cerebrally, intellectually, you know, they can see and understand how the manipulations work, but because they're emotion and have feelings and, you know, there's no user manual telling them how to psychologically and emotionally, you know, address their own needs, and they've been, you know, caught in the Stockholm syndrome, you know, like everybody else has. You know, basically there's a lot of intensity as they shift, because as they catch themselves in programs and they're aware that they're running a program, they're thinking, I should know better than that. I'm more evolved than that. I shouldn't be doing this to myself. This is self-sabotage. Then shame goes into guilt, which then springs a denial mechanism. So then it's like, no, then they don't even want to acknowledge to even themselves that they're doing something like that. So they're still kind of co-opted in that way by the matrix, because the mental malware is kind of like retaliating. So it's trying to retaliate and lock you in. People become aware of it, and then instead of hitting the pause button and go, okay, I see what this is doing, let's make a better choice than I would normally make, their neural networks are like freaking out. And this has been a very common thing. And I've noticed that people within their belief structures, in order for something to be fully real for them, it needs to meet a required misery level in order for them to accept it. Otherwise, if it's too good, too fast, with no misery contrast attached, then it's too good to be true. And because people are more afraid of their success than their failure, because they're used to failure, it's normalized, they're comfortable with it, they know how to navigate it, but success they don't. So right now human consciousness is starting to untangle itself from this mindfuck web, to the point that I've even started seeing new agers start to shift away from the shun the dark and going more into, you know, like what, like as you say, information is just information, and we need to take personal responsibility for our, you know, for our own part in things. So I'm even seeing, you know, a shift starting with new agers, and it's very painful and confusing for them, but they've decided that going through that pain and confusion is better than living this waking death zombie nightmare.
Well, you know, they've been brutalized, the new ages, they really have. I mean, they've been waiting to ascend for the last 25 years, and they're starting to realize that they were sold a lie. That what they were sold was a doctrine, basically, of spiritual narcissism, where you sit there and wait for life to end. I mean, what's that all about? You're sitting there preparing for the afterlife. What about this life? You're here for a reason. Maybe you should participate. Maybe you wouldn't have to spend your time meditating to get away from all this dark stuff if you would actually look at it and address it. You know, and a lot of them are in that state of high vibration, and they won't look at anything that lowers their vibration. So really, they're in a state of fear. They're in a state of fear of processing certain forms of light, and they're calling it love, and that's what they're projecting.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's completely bizarre.
It's the wolf in sheep's clothing, as it were. What I like to tell them in these days, that a lot of them are surprisingly receptive to this now. They didn't used to be. When it comes to ascension, I tell them, the joke is that you're all already ascended. You're just taking the 3D blindfolds off as you paradigm shift. The thing that you've been looking for, you already are it. And now they're looking
at the thing.
Like, whoa, that's profound.
Yeah, well, we're the ones we've been waiting for. I mean, we always have been. But like you say before, there's so much complacency. And this is what a lot of the movies and theater and all this stuff's about as well. You know, we see these movies of these dystopian futures, and we look at them and go, oh, we're not there yet, so we're good. And we become complacent again. Well, yeah, we are there. It's just not as quite as overt as what it is in that movie, or overt as what it is in that movie. But we are there yet.
You know,
these things are pressure relief valves, you know. All these things, sports, all these things are pressure relief valves. We didn't have action movies, and we didn't have sports, and we didn't have war on TV. we would have been a revolution long ago. They really would have. But all of these things are release the pressure from us and put us back into that state of complacency. It's a very, very clever program, but it's very, very deliberate.
You know what, though, Max? There's one thing I've been wanting to tell you that I keep forgetting that I just now remembered because you kind of reminded me. One thing that I've been seeing a lot of that you probably haven't seen really much of because you've been like way too busy to see this, but I also, you know, like to watch a lot of movies and TV shows, although of course I'm very selective about what I watch. And what I've noticed, as things are shifting more towards the positive, towards the light, whatever euphemistic term someone wants to put on that, a lot of these TV programs are starting to be designed to deprogram people. Disney especially has started shifting a little more to the light than the dark. Like one example is there's a show called Once Upon a Time. You may or may not be familiar with it, but the show is total paradigm shift in deprogramming, and it's great. And it's done subtly enough to stay just under the elite's radar, and is not so overt that, you know, it's triggering people. It's allowing for the deprogramming to kind of slip right in behind the scenes. There have been other shows that I've seen that try to do too much whistleblowing too fast. They get on the elite's radar, and all of a sudden the show is magically canceled. Surprise, surprise. But, you know, so there are good people that are in Hollywood now that are kind of learning the art of staying just under the radar of the elite so that they can deprogram the masses through certain mainstream content, but without the higher-ups noticing and putting the kibosh on it, because they're learning that when they put out too much too fast, the show gets canceled like that.
Well, yeah, you know, but you've got to watch what they're putting out with the stuff as well. I mean, very often they're spinning a lot of disinformation in these shows as well. Things like The X-Files. I mean, The X-Files exposed a lot of good stuff. It showed there was a deep state, and then it associated with all of this really bizarre UFO stuff and all this stuff which is provable disinformation, and basically coined the term conspiracy theorist. So that suddenly conspiracies all became theory. So you've got to look at how they program people through these things as well. I mean, there may be a certain amount of, I'm very questioned about anything that shows what we would term awakening. For what is the other subtext beneath that? I mean, I'm not familiar with the shows that you're talking about, but you've got to look at the subtext and the associative things that they associate these sorts of truth with.
Oh, I know.
This is
the way classic works.
They put in enough real information to make it believable, and they put smatterings of truth in there, but ultimately it's all disinformation. You know, you get the truth and you embellish it to the point that it becomes unbelievable and associated with all sorts of stuff, yeah. And people throw the baby out with the bath, so you got to watch that as well. Yeah. You know, but I'll be interested to see the shows. I mean, hopefully there is some sort of deprogramming happening on television. There must be people within the movie industry, you know, concerned about the situation we're going as well, so... Hopefully we'll see a little bit more of that. But I mean, I recommend people throw their televisions away and just get involved in their communities. That would be a good thing. This is why I want to close my Facebook accounts as well, because I think we need to get off social media and get involved in life again. Social media is destroying life. It's destroying people's communication skills. It's pitting people against each other. It's creating so much animosity and division because people are just taking text too seriously. Now, when you read stuff in text, you can't put emotion into it. You don't read the body language. You don't hear the voice. You don't really know what the person's saying. You just read it in text, and you take it as black and white. And, you know, people are taking each other the wrong way. They're taking each other to the extreme. And it's just creating more and more problems, I think. So I think we need to move away from social media. If we're going to use social media, maybe things like this where we're actually talking and communicating to each other in real time, not just text.
Yeah, just to let you know, I view social media as a tool just like any other, And as much as true as everything you just said is, all that stuff does happen, there's a lot of good stuff that happens too. I mean, most of my experiences on social media have been absolutely positive. I've made a lot of really great friends, a lot of which, you know, at minimum, you know, we've communicated in, you know, audio, video, you know, mediums privately and publicly like this. And, you know, even better, I've made friends in person and things like that. So, I mean, social media is just a tool. Most of my experiences have been positive. I've had a few negative ones. So, I mean, what you're saying about social media is equally true. People got to be careful to not fall into that trap. But at the same time, I've had so many positive and uplifting experiences as well. And that aspect of social media is equally true and equally valid. So everybody's just got to have their discernment on high alert and give themselves sovereign permission to deal with the people that they resonate with. And I think that's been another big theme of 2017 that I've been seeing. A lot of people are starting to be more willing to let go of things that no longer resonate and let those drift and welcome in new and better things. Because I think one of humanity's biggest problems is that we've been taught to put up so many walls to keep us from knowing ourselves, to keep us from knowing other people. We put up so many walls, and as we start to let go of the walls and stop getting so control freaky, then we're willing to let people go who need to go, and we're willing to let people come in who need to come in, instead of trying to control freak our own reality all the time.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, there is a lot of positive stuff happens on social media, but, you know, look at Facebook, even the name Facebook. I mean, it's a data miner. It's a data miner that searches for people by facial recognition. And, you know, when I look at it, I mean, I use social media to share information as well. But with what they've done with things like Facebook, there's algorithms in place now whereby information just doesn't get shared. You know, I post stuff and people just don't see it, because there's algorithms to prevent it. I mean, Facebook knows what it wants shared and it knows what it doesn't want shared. And there's certain things that just don't get shared. So, you know, how much of a difference am I making by using Facebook? I mean, I might reach an extra 50 or 100 people by posting a video there, but out of like 45,000, you know, combined followers on all the pages I've got, there's not really a lot of people. Am I simply putting all those people who've connected with me on a watch list? So, you know, how much good am I doing? How much am I achieving by even using it?
You've reached a lot more people than you think. And man, I give people this analogy all the time. Think of yourself as the stone that gets tossed to the center of the pond, and the earth is the pond.
Oh, yeah, okay. I know all that.
That stone is not going to be able to see most of its own ripples, but you are making them. There's people that I know that your words have helped that you don't know.
Oh, yeah,
I
know.
You have no way of knowing they exist, but, you know.
Well, yeah, but I'm just saying, with social media, with Facebook, I mean, the amount of people I'm reaching on Facebook as opposed to the amount of people that I'm potentially putting on a watch list, how much good am I actually doing by using Facebook? Because I know the government wants me to use Facebook. The government loves people to use Facebook, because through Facebook they get all the information that they need on everybody. They used to have to do years of detecting on people and investigating on people to find out what they can find out in 5 minutes on Facebook now. So, you know, I just wonder, because I don't use mobile phones, I don't use credit cards, I just don't participate in the system, and yet I use Facebook. And so I'm contributing to the government's data mining. I'm contributing to the CIA control grid by simply using Facebook. So I just wonder, I mean, well, it's a fine line. I need to weigh up the pros and the cons. And I don't see, I mean, like I say, I mean, I've met some great people and all that sort of stuff, and there are benefits to it. But the cons of it, I mean, the fact that it is basically a government-controlled data mining site, that's what it is.
Those people... Just those people being themselves online if it's going to put them on a watch list at all, has equal potential of putting them on a watch list, whether you're in the equation or not, because that's how sophisticated the systems are. So just anybody saying anything online, everything's getting categorized and monitored and whatever. And I mean, it's not just Facebook either. I mean, it's as I like to tell people, if you want privacy, go to Mars. It's, you know, or out of the solar system, because, you know, it's everything. You know, there's no getting away from it. And I don't even think privacy is the biggest issue. I think censorship is the biggest freaking issue, because, you know, once you have total censorship, you're fucking done. It's game over. You can have breaches of privacy and still have a chance of, you know, winning the long game. But once you have complete censorship, you've lost the whole game.
Well, you know, we've got censorship to a degree now. I think we're allowed to get away with doing what we do just simply so they can get tabs on people. Because they don't care. I mean, they don't care what the law is, and they don't care what you believe your rights are. These are people, these are pedophiles who are harvesting most of the human race. They'll just take you out and kill you. They don't care. They have no morals. They have no scruples. They don't abide by the legal system. The legal system's there to tie us up in red tape, not to provide any remedy for us, and not to be used to hold them accountable for anything. So you've really got to look at it. You know, I just wonder how much good I'm doing on Facebook. I mean, it isn't something that I really participate in much at all anyway. So I just think, you know, it's a thorn in their side if I don't use it. So I shouldn't use it, you know? So,
you know,
I'd love to, if I ever get arrested or ever get asked by anything by the police, I mean, the first thing they ask for is your cell phone details and your Facebook account. It was simple to say to them, I actually don't have either of those. And they're going to go, oh, you mean we actually have to do some detective work and find out stuff about you ourselves? Well, modern police are too stupid. They wouldn't even know how to do that, you know? So just to see the look on their faces, it's worth cancelling the Facebook account. I mean, you know, I just kind of have that feeling about it, you know? So.
Yeah. One thing I've also noticed, too, is that as more people start to awaken and they're processing their shame and they're dealing with their self-worth and the more they face their own self-worth and that they are worthy and deserving and everything you've ranted on for forever and a day, once they start to realize that, they tend to go into what I refer to as abundant shock, that I also refer to as the problem is that there is no problem. If someone has neural networks that have gotten comfortable with and used to and familiar with the idea of normal equals there's always problems or drama or some sort or this and that and never any good things, and then all of a sudden things start getting better for them and they have realizations and things start getting a little bit more positive for them, once that happens too much, it creates cognitive dissonance, because now their external reality is starting to defy their own core belief systems. And of course, a similar, equal and opposite inversion of the same thing happens if information is more negative than what they're used to. Again, still the reactions caused by the deep shame and self-worth issues that they have. Now, what I've also noticed is once people clear out enough of these issues, they're able to much better handle you know, the details about the global stage. Whereas any human being, when they get too much information overload and cognitive dissonance, they go into anxiety. And, you know, that, and I'm not talking about the SJWs making excuses and trying to promote political correctness. I'm talking about legitimate anxiety that messes with your head. But when people like this are willing and determined to proceed forward and to shift through it and face themselves, they do start to become very, very empowered people. I just want to reference my friend Katarina Roy. You have talked to her once, and she used to be one of those people that was still dealing with so much of her own Stockholm syndrome and being manipulated by narcissists in her life and this and that, that even simple geopolitics used to just create so much cognitive dissonance in her brain and confusion that she was terrified of it. She didn't want to deal with it. But now at this point that she's worked out a lot more of her shame issues and she's really raised her sense of self-worth, she can talk geopolitics like a boss. So my point in telling you this is simply to show you that there are people being shifted, and you've also indirectly helped Katarina as well, because she's heard you talk and stuff too. She's not like a hardcore listener of your stuff, but she's heard things here and there, and you have a very eloquent, you know, way, sensible way of explaining yourself. So, you know, you break it down easy. And that's another thing that can create cognitive dissonance with people too, because when something is very easy to understand and clear to understand, but it also contradicts the core belief system, that makes the cognitive dissonance even greater. But everybody's going through their processes on this, and it's a turbulent, dark night of the soul. But man, once people really get through it, they become so freaking empowered. So I want you to know that that's the effect you're having on people. And yeah, it takes a period of time, however long it takes someone to go from shame to start getting into empowerment. That's their personal journey. But I want you to know that these personal journeys are happening. You're not out there speaking for nothing.
Yeah, I know. I know a lot of people are listening. And a lot of people, like you say, they're very uncomfortable with change. They get locked into their whole core belief system. It's like a lot of even the independent media. I mean, I've noticed whenever I've tried to do anything that's going to create unity or anything that might lead to remedy, people attack it, people will not do it. There's so many people who the fight against the system is their life. It's all they know. And if they weren't fighting against the system and getting out there and being an activist every day, if we actually healed everything and the world started going in the right direction, they wouldn't know what to do with themselves. And also a lot of people would lose their income, because there's a lot of that that's going on YouTube now as well. There's been a lot of, you know, monetization of accounts and sensationalizing. Like in the last 2 years, your YouTube has become almost like the mainstream media, and as fact is everything is over sensationalized. You know, you get anything you can on anybody who's got a name, post whatever dirt you can get on them, just as clickbait, just to get an income. You know, I get that. People either get that. You'll see bad articles, bad jackets put on everybody you can think of, just to get the clicks, just to get the income. Sensationalized news reports that are loosely based in truth, just to get the income. So there's been a lot of that go on as well. So a lot of people wouldn't know what to do if we won, if the world just changed. They wouldn't know how to deal with peace. They wouldn't know how to deal with prosperity. They wouldn't know how to deal with freedom.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of people want freedom, but they don't know what it looks like, and they've got no idea what the path to it is. All they believe is freedom means they don't have to do anything or be responsible for anything, and no one's going to ask them for anything, or they don't have to pay for anything. That seems to be what most people think freedom is, and really that's not what it is. You know, freedom is self-responsibility, and most people...
Or even worse, you know, the people that really believe in their heart of hearts that they're wanting to fight tyranny and make this world a better place, they never stop to ask the question, okay, what if we win? What then? What are you going to replace it with? And I've seen these two extremes where people either, they, you know, they don't ask that question to begin with, or people do ask that question and they come up with resource-based economics, this, that, and whatever, but they fail to recognize that any fool can break even a perfect system. No one ever stops to consider transitional phases, you know, between point A and B. It's common sense for us to realize that you don't go from a baby to a college graduate in 10 seconds. There's this transitional phase of growing up, to where the baby goes through its years of life and puberty and this and that, et cetera, and then on into adulthood. Similarly, as a society, as a civilization, there needs to be transitional phases out of our current system, and then eventually into something like resource-based economics. I think the middle of that journey would be equity-based economics, to where this fiat scumbag, you know, Ponzi scheme monetary system no longer exists. Governments actually make their own money. The Federal Reserve is gone, and you know, things move in a better direction. And then eventually transitioning out of the need for government at all, because government just means mind control. But people can't quit a system cold turkey because it creates too much cognitive dissonance. You need transitional phases. So people are either locked in a future. Sorry, go ahead.
Well, yeah, you do. You need transitional stages. I mean, you can't go straight from you know, slavery to anarchy. It's not going to work. But the thing is, I mean, even talking about bringing in resource-based economies or whatever, you know, we don't have to construct a new system. We don't have to do anything. All we've got to do is change our moral compass and apply that to our everyday life, and the system has to change around us. It's as simple as that.
Yeah.
You know, all of this corruption, all of this war, all of this miseducation, the homelessness, the profiteering from people, the scarcity that we're in, the fiat money system. If people were doing the right thing, they wouldn't be supporting the fiat money system. If they changed what's in their hearts, they wouldn't support it. It's simple as that.
Well, that's
every aspect of our life. And if they bring along a resource-based economy, the Zeitgeist movement, Ubuntu or whatever, if people haven't changed their moral compass, then it isn't going to matter. Within 10 years, we'll be back where we started because we're still doing the wrong thing. And if we were to change our moral compass, we don't have to do anything else. It's really that simple. The whole world organically change around us. It's so simple. And people can't see the forest for the trees. They can't see that it has to come from within and that that's where the change is going to be. They want someone to send them a newsletter to say, because I supported your movement, I've got the newsletter that says the world has changed. Now I can continue going to work and doing the shopping and all the stuff that I'm doing. Well, how has it changed? You know, if you haven't done something about it yourself, then it's not going to change. That's why people vote for Trump and think he's going to lead him to safety. He's not. You have to lead yourself to safety by changing what's in here and applying it to the world. And the fact that people can't
I would really love it. I'm not saying he will or won't. I'm on the fence. I don't know. I would really love it if Trump decided to start talking to the people about personal responsibility and about sovereignty and about things like what you talk about to try to motivate people out of this false sense of, you know, of entitlement. And
he won't do any of that because he's a player. He's playing the same agenda. Yeah. He's playing the same foreign agenda as the previous administrations. All he's doing is giving them all the band-aids for all the mess that the previous administrations have created, which is why they created that mess. So he could come along and give you all this appeasement and escalate the global agenda, which is exactly what he's doing.
Yeah. But what you were saying about you know, the hearts and minds needing to change and the reality change around, that's exactly why transitional phases are needed, and that's exactly where those transitional phases come from. Transitional phases are neither created nor provided by governments, by corporations, by anything like that. Transitional phases they are created by the people because it's needed. Like you said, an idea whose time has come. Those are the transitional phases.
Yeah,
and I think we're slowly starting to see them.
Thing. I mean, if people started doing the right thing and what they do, hang on, you get to work and hang on, I can't do this. This is the wrong thing. It doesn't matter what it says here. It's the wrong thing to do. And they just did the right thing. That would create ripples. That would create ripples. And you see all these businesses and companies falling apart that were polluting the environment. I mean, the transitional period would be an organic thing, which would manifest itself out of necessity for there to be something like that. And if everyone was in their moral compass, we'd go along with it. It would work. There might be psychopaths who don't want to do that. Well, that's fine. They can go live on Christmas Island or something. Whatever. Get them over there. Get them off. Totally. We can put all these politicians and stuff on Christmas Island. Give them all a hammer. They can have their war. Not a problem. Just don't involve the rest of the world, you know. So
I always like to say you vote with your money, not at the polls, because no matter who you vote for at the polls, Wall Street gets in no matter what. But you know, just like you've watched the Matrix movies, haven't you?
Yeah.
Well, you know that one scene where it said that the machines of the Matrix are directly dependent upon the rules, you know, of their matrix. Well, similarly, all these corporations and everything depend on the money system. If the money system was suddenly just gone, these corporations would have no power to do anything. You know, money is like the lubricant in the gears of the corporate machine. You take that away, the machine grinds to a halt. Also, just recently, for example, you've heard of Tropicana, orange juice company, right?
Yeah.
Well, there's so much more awareness here about GMOs now. And no, I'm happy to report, you know, I live here in Chicago, on a local radio station. I don't listen to much local radio, but I happen to be in a local mart and they had it, you know, playing over the speakers and whatever. And I was at the checkout counter. There was actually a commercial on talking about how GMOs are dangerous and, you know, information about why GMOs are bad and all this and that. And that was on local AM/FM radio. And I was like, holy shit, right? Like, you know, that was freaking awesome. Well, because of the rise in awareness about GMOs, and there's even like cell phone bar scanners where you can scan the barcode of an item and really actually find out whether it's truly GMO or not. Basically, sales for anything GMO have lowered substantially in the United States, plus the majority of countries outside of the United States will not buy GMO garbage. So Tropicana started seeing steady declines in its profits. So they were actually forced to go non-GMO in order to raise their profits again, because they couldn't export to too many places because most places won't buy, you know, most countries won't buy GMO bullshit, and sales started going down here in the United States. So, you know, if they're not bringing in the profits, they're screwed. So they had to adapt to the will of the people. The people voted with their money.
Yeah. Well, that really helps, and that's what people should do. That's what, you know, the whole boycott, divestment, sanctions about. And yeah, people should stop supporting anything that supports harm, injury, or death. Any company that can be seen to be supporting anything that supports harm, injury, or death, just stop supporting it. Stop supporting GMO. GMOs are dangerous. They're causing sterility in three generations. We know this. We know that's what they do. There's been all sorts of studies. Just stop supporting it. Stop supporting anything that about the system that you don't like. And yeah, vote with your wallets. We should do that. I mean, this is why I've been calling for a day of non-compliance for so many years. Imagine what would happen if we all stayed home and just didn't spend money for a day. It would send a shockwave around the world. Yeah, the whole economic system would fall apart if we didn't spend money for a day. Wall Street would crumble. It wouldn't know what to do. Imagine if none of the Dow index, nothing moved for the day. That all freak, mate. All those people on the floor would be going, oh my God, what do I write down? Where's my reality gone? You know? So we could really make a difference by just staying home for a day. You know, that's what real non-compliance is. That's what a real revolution would be. You don't have to go and march in the street. Just stay home and don't get involved in the system. For 24 hours, just do not get involved in the system. Turn off your cell phone, turn off your television, don't spend any money, and spend some time with your family. Imagine if the whole world did that, David. It'd be incredible. Oh, here's the guys walking to the
that reminds me. Oh, that reminds me of something else I wanted to tell you. Oh, thank you for reminding me. You know how you want to make the 15th of some month or another International Non-Compliance Day?
Yeah.
My suggestion there.
I've had a good
one. In order to give it enough momentum, why don't you just make it so that the 15th of every month is International Non-Compliance Day, so that, you know, if you don't get the numbers you're really looking for the first try, well, there's plenty of other months after the first one, and you can gauge month by month, you know, how the response to that is going. Or if you just make it once a year, if you make it once a year, it's going to take way longer to gauge. It's not going to be as effective.
That may work. That may be an idea. So I think there's a woman trying to do that already. I think there's a woman I've got on Skype. I've got so many people on Skype, and I feel really embarrassed. I can't remember her name. Karen. I think a lady called Karen is actually already trying to do that on the 15th of every month. Perhaps I'll have to contact her and see what she says. I've got so much on, so many projects on, it's hard to know where to even begin. It's difficult to get anything.
I feel, yeah.
But so now I've got all these tours. I mean, I've got 9 months of traveling ahead of me now. This is going to be the last tour I do for a while because I'm just getting too old for it. I really need to have some time off, and I want to go and get some films finished. I haven't finished a film since 2012. They're going to pull down the tower. They're out there now.
You know,
we're going to lose the internet in a minute because I can.
Oh.
The workers have just walked out to the tower. We're having our tower pulled down here today, folks. This is life in the Amazon. We have very intimate internet here in the Amazon. I can't even complain because I'm in the Amazon. It's so bad, and the IT guy came out to fix it, and it still didn't fix anything. So now they're here to replace the tower for us with another one that's 4 meters higher.
It's still been really great to have you on, and I'm sure we'll probably hook up again on here in March when you're in Hawaii. So anybody in Hawaii in March, be on the lookout for Max Igan, and you're also going to be in Ohio in person at Rock the Farm as well. And that's going to be when again?
I'll be there.
I'll also be at the Free of Mind Conference in Philadelphia in April 20th, I think. And I'm going to speak in Acapulco in Mexico in a couple of days. Yeah. And then
when are you going to be at Rock the Farm?
Rock the Farm will be the 5th of May, I think. I think it's the 5th. 5th okay. and 6th, I think. That weekend, weekend, the 5th is on. It's around then. And if you go to my website, thecrowhouse.com, you'll see a banner there that says Combo Workshops Hawaii. And there's a series of workshops I'm doing there over a 5-week period in Hawaii, which is really wonderful for the guy. And there's a retreat there called Earth Song, which is interesting because that's the name of one of the films I'm working on. And it's just wonderful for the people from the retreat to be flying me out there and putting up for them. I'm going to do some talks and some meet and greets and just some hang out with people and do some combo workshops and just kind of check the place out. So I'm really looking forward to that. Then go from there to a Free of Mind in Philadelphia on April 20th. And then go from there to a gig there on April 22nd. Hopefully with Marty Leeds. I did an interview with him last night. I gave him a bit of a hard time, said that I definitely would want to see him there. And that's the way it is. Are you still there?
Okay, and I am back. Sorry about that. Both me and Max having technical difficulties at the same time. He was saying that they might be starting to work on the tower at the moment, synchronistically, at the same time. My computer had issues and crashed, so that was incredibly interesting. I am typing with Max right now to see if he can get back in. Yeah, the energies have definitely been interesting. Max will be back in here in a moment if he can be, if they haven't fully taken down the tower yet, and if he can get back in. And in the meantime, while we are waiting to see whether or not that happens, I just want to say yet again that the Paradigm Shift in Educational Comedy, we've got the Patreon link. So that's patreon.com/PSEC Media. That's PSEC Media. For Max Egan's Patreon, that's patreon.com/Max Egan. And I had mentioned Katarina Roy earlier, patreon.com/Katarina Roy, seeing as we mentioned her earlier as well. So, and of course, for Max Egan's website, you can hit him up there at thecrowhouse.com. And he also has a YouTube channel, of course. And once I can get back into alignment with him here, I will be just asking him whether he wants the link to this this YouTube file once everything is saved in, or if he wants the file direct from me on Skype or whatever. I'm not exactly sure how long that we've been on air at the moment. Hopefully it's been a decently long time. And even though we synchronistically seem to have aligned with them, you know, his internet connection literally, like, you know, the tower being, like, removed and rebuilt and crap. We will be having him on again in March, because that's going to be his next available open window to be able to get back on and have internet and all that stuff. So, yeah, he's going to be in Hawaii in March, which is pretty cool. Katarina Roy is in Hawaii. You can go to thecrowhouse.com to look up all the details of exactly where Max is going to be and when. And we will get him back on here as soon as possible. I think the conversation we were having is very interesting and very relevant. And I hope the rest of you watching maybe think about these topics and consider discussing them amongst yourselves on whatever platforms you all have going, because, you know, the idea of just, you know, this wave of compassion hitting the planet and everybody just kind of getting triggered and facing their shit, like, that's just been like a big theme of 2017 so far. And, you know, I think that humanity's at a point where it's being offered a really good opportunity to, you know, just kind of face our own messes and, you know, clean that out and clean out all of this this shame that society has, you know, put into us, all this low self-esteem and, you know, false sense of guilt, and, you know, realize that we can be the person that we want to be. We can be the change that, you know, we want to see in the world, and that we see the world as we are, not as it is. So, you know, you can be the change you want to create. And yeah, you know, it's going to require facing yourself and sorting through paradigms and shifting through paradigms. You can't just, like, you know, meditate and go off into the fifth dimension or whatever, because guess what? As I have sung on one of my song parodies called Dealing with a New Age Paradigm, 5D you will not earn if you just watch the world burn. So, you know, I'm not saying, you know, don't be new agey. I'm not saying don't believe in quantum physics. I'm not saying don't believe in Jesus. I'm not saying don't believe in God. I'm just saying that, you know, God said, seek and ye shall find, because God helps those who help themselves. We get presented with opportunities in our lives, and whether we see that these opportunities as opportunities or as burdens, it's kind of like, you know, the negative, if you kind of view it the same as manure, meaning literally shit, you know, we can roll around in the manure and act as if it's victimizing us, or we can use that manure and plant the garden that we'd prefer, you know, taking the negative and viewing it as a positive opportunity for positive change, instead of doing all this shun the dark shit or oh back Satan or whatever, you know, make peace with those demons inside of us so that we can stop psychologically projecting outside of us. Because all of the external dysfunction that creates genocide, war, and all the stuff outside of us that we don't like, it's because we are not, as individuals, willing to face ourselves inside of ourselves and clear out all this programmed shame that society and peer pressure and all that, you know, has put into us that fucks with our heads. And, you know, the more that we can clear that out, you know, the more effective we're going to be at viewing the negative as a positive opportunity for positive change. So, you know, it's quite an adventure. It's quite a journey. It's not going to be, you know, be easy. You know, there's going to be some challenges, but, you know, through challenge, there's growth. You know, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, right? So, I would just like to suggest in closing, because, yeah, obviously Max's tower's, you know, being chopped down here, so should probably make an ending statement and close this out. Just, you know, believe nothing, disbelieve nothing, question everything, be calm about it. You know, when you feel emotionally triggered inside, instead of reacting in shame, like, oh, I should know better than to be acting like this, and then go into denial mode and have it co-opt you, just you know, own your emotions. Realize that even your negative emotions are your property and you have the right to feel them. And once you give yourself the right to feel them, you're going to stop this negative feedback loop of suffering inside of you. And then it's going to be a storm that goes through and then it passes and the proverbial sun will come back out again and you'll gain a bit more of your sanity and self-control, because you can think and make wiser decisions when your brain isn't constipated. So respect your pace of learning, be easy on yourself, and when you start seeing, you know, your programmed neural networks flaring up and getting triggered, instead of going into guilt and denial, hit the pause button on it and go, okay, I see why that's happening there. Now, what would I rather do? And when you're not in judgment against the negative emotions that you're feeling, you can hit that pause button. But when you're not owning your emotions and you're thinking, oh my God, I shouldn't be sad, I shouldn't be angry, I shouldn't be this, I shouldn't be that, oh, I'm a bad person for thinking that, feeling that, etc. When you do that, you lock yourself into slavery in that pattern, and you start to do and think and feel all the things you're not wanting, you know, and it just becomes a big horrible mess, and then you end up in the loony bin or a politician, depending on your social class. Same thing anyway, right? So, anyway. Thank you all for watching. Hope you all have a nice day, night, morning, whatever it is on your part of the planet. And catch you later, and we will have Max Igan back as soon as possible. So thank you. Love y'all. Catch you later. Peace out.